to the E to the L to the U to the X to the E to the Hello guys, it is Qwerty Afro here, bringing you another Train Simulator 2016 video. Today I'm finally covering the JustTrains Class 222 Meridian. Finally, that's been recently released. I thought I'd give it a go as well because I had to get it because it's been in development so far. I've been looking throughout the whole development and whatever. I've been hearing mixed views of going around that it's like it's good, but then it's not like perfect. People are saying it is, it is obviously based on the Voyager, the Super Voyager and the Voyager, but people are saying that it's not too unique. It's a little bit too much copied from the Voyager and the Super Voyager, but I'll see for myself. I've heard loads of things, I've watched loads of things as well, but this is my take now, my first time actually driving it. I've only driven it once on the stream, just very briefly, but now we're going to do a full scenario on it. And also, by the way, I need to get a video out on World Ship Simulator, which actually released today, or whenever I'm uploading this video, it will be released, and I'll try and get a video of that up, because that's a continuation of European Ship Simulator, which kind of failed, and now they're bringing it back with a new developer to do World Ship Simulator, which is more now in a fictional world instead of a non-fiction world, and they are going through early access, and hopefully this time they can do it right. From what I'm seeing, it looks good, and I'll get a video up that shortly as well. Today we're going to be doing this JustTrains Derby departure scenario, which comes with the JustTrains Class 222. Drive the 1F68725 St Pancras to Derby, from St Pancras to Bedford in the summer of 2006. So we're being a little bit nostalgic here and going back in time a bit, and instead of using the East Midlands train livery, we're going to be going back when it was before Midland Mainline, just for a bit of nostalgia. I thought, you know, not many people see this actual livery. I thought I'd do a video of actually this area. And there's also even up here, at one time I might even do the Hull Trains one. I'll probably do one of each. I'll do the East Midlands Hull Trains one, and now, which in this video, we're going to be doing the Midland Main Line. Before we get into the train, shouts do go to Steenie2210 and Trainz GaimZ and Models. That's again Steenie, I'm guessing, 2210 and Trainz GaimZ and Models. Their links and stuff will be down below. Show them some love, what am I saying? Also, the link for this train will be down below, and also the route if you want all the kind of information and stuff on where to get these kind of things, they'll be down below. So, I'll see you guys in the cab of this 222 Meridian. Welcome on board, guys. This is the Class 222 Meridian. Good evening, driver. Please open the doors with tea and then set up your cab prior to departing at 7:25, bound for Derby. We will stop at Bedford at 8 o'clock for a crew change. That is all good stuff. Let's just quickly have a look what we're doing. We have about a few minutes. I do believe the train is primarily all set up, in my opinion, but oh, look at this. It's been a long time since I've seen this livery. Just look at that, gorgeous. I think it looks better than the actual current livery. Oh, we're actually at the back of the train. It does, I think it looks slightly better than the current livery. The current livery is okay, but I'm more of a fan of this. Even though this isn't the most exciting livery, I do believe it looks much, much better than the current East Midlands trains. But, you know, long live Midland Mainline. They were an alright train operating company, I guess. Anyway, let's get into the cab. Need to set up a few. I think everything pretty much is set up. The DRA doesn't actually have to be on because it's a green light. And we're currently driving a 5-car. Let's get the reverser in. Oh no, we have to get the master key in. Then get the reverser in. AWS reset, which is all good. And then that's the DSD alert. The driver vigilance system, DVD or DSD, I'm not too sure. Driver surveillance detection, vigilance system, I forget it, you know, I've been playing this too long, I'm an old man. Anyway, I think generally that's it. I think we just need to set up the lights, which we're just going to quickly put on today. Oh, by the way, We have to open the doors. Slid down there to the back there, but yeah, we have to open the doors. Let's check the inside. Well, it's pretty different to the East Midlands interior, but is this how Midland Mainline used to be? These purple, ugly seats? This looks terrible. But this is the passenger view for the class 222. It's all different for the... Oh, and then we have the annoying phone call, which... Oh, still plays. That's really annoying. Are we seriously going to have to listen to that, even in the cab here? Anyway, lights are on. Are tail lights on? Yes, tail lights are on. Barnsley. Oh, we can actually try and actually turn the destination. Right way, driver. Next stop is Bedford for 8 o'clock. I think we can actually change this to... Ah, yeah, there we go. So, let's just change it to Derby, because, you know, that's just more correct. You can change it with Control F12 and Control Shift F12 to change it back to the previous kind of destination you had it set. So that is very nice, and it also, if I can speak, changes it there, which is very nice. Anyway, let's get this train going because we don't want to be too late. Oh, that just looks gorgeous. Anyway. Give it a little horn. Let's see how the horn is. The thing is with the sounds, I can't judge it too much because, to be honest, in my opinion, I think the Super Voyager and the Meridian pretty much sound the same. I don't. There obviously are differences, and I definitely know that. Out of all of them, the most different one is probably the Meridian, and what I've been hearing about what people have been saying is that they've just basically, in a way, just copied and pasted the sounds from the Super Voyager and the Voyager. I'm not saying that those don't have bad sounds, they actually have very nice sounds, but I think people were just getting a little bit annoyed with that. But visually, this looks pretty good. I did kind of notice, and I've watched on Daniel Maverick's channel, who does Train Simulator News, when he was going through this train and actually evaluating it and seeing what was actually buggy with it. He was saying that like the wheels were going in the wrong direction, and I do believe that they have patched that, but there have been loads of little odd defects with this train that could have not really been there. They could have been wiped out if they, you know, did a proper beta of it and whatever. But overall, I do like it. I've ridden this train a few times when I have actually come up to Leicester with train, which I don't do too much. And actually, as recently, when I actually used it, you actually would have sworn a picture on my Instagram when I was actually on a 222. I was actually coming down from Derby to Leicester, which is a very short trip, very nice trip. I passed like Nottingham, and you get to see the huge coal chimneys that are at the coal station just outside of Nottingham, and it just goes past in a blur, and they're so huge. Anyway, this is the cabin. The cabin position is a bit. I know that I don't like. People would recommend right now that I just move the FOV a little bit back. I tend not to like doing that. I don't know why. It just feels a little unnatural. Like, I prefer the natural FOV that the game does as standard. When I mess around with the FOV, it starts to look a little bit unnatural. And it makes everything look a little bit too small. While, to be honest, in real life, if you moved back a bit, it turns small, but not too small relative to like where you're standing. When you move back, it's still relatively large, like buttons and stuff are large, but in the game the FOV just moves it back, and it just makes it a little bit too small for my liking. Anyway, what is going on here? Can we have this on this fancy nice computer that you can do you can check things on? I'm guessing you can I'm clicking things. I don't know what else you can do, but you can start this train from like a cold state and do all these kind of like alarm sequences, etc., which is basically similar to the Super Voyager and the Voyager, which also is available from JustTrains. I don't think you can do it with the Dovetail Games version, though. I'm not too sure. Someone could tell me. I don't think you can do it. Oh, driver's vigilant. Vigilant system alarm there, activating and telling me I'm awake. Can I turn on the... I'd love to turn on the instrument panel lights. I do believe there is a button to do it. Just need to... there we go. Right, there we go. Perfect. Right. One thing you also notice straight away when you're in this cab is it's damn well insulated. And that's one thing, that's another thing that people have been commenting about. It's so insulated that it kind of, you can't hear anything. And this train makes a lot of noise. I've been on it in the passengers' carriages and whatever. You can hear the train. The train makes so much noise. It's because every carriage has motors underneath it. While, like, say, with a HST, all the motors are either at the front or the back, and then the carriages pretty much have nothing below them to make noise. To be honest, when I come to think of it, I don't actually know what's actually stored beneath, like, HST, like, Mark III carriages or whatever. Like, what are those, like, under rails used for, like, where it just looks like stuff is there? I don't know, it's like, something that can be stored there, or like is there actually something in there, like I don't know, probably for toilets, like reservoir tanks or whatever. But what else is under there? Like, could someone tell me? I'm not sure. I never really thought about that, but I've always looked at it and thought, why do they have those undercarriage bits? Like, what's actually there? Interesting thought there to kind of think about. Anyway, we're on the MML, going now past West Hampstead, which I did a nice little comparison when I did my North London video, and I was showing you that there are three. What the hell is that? Oh, we have a brake fault, driver. Please bring the train to a settled halt. Once stopped, you need to move the combined power and reverser handles to the neutral position. Do not proceed until all warning lights have extinguished. Hopefully, the issue won't show again. Okay, let's bring this train to a nice halt. Didn't actually know that we're going to actually have brake fault failure here, so we're just going to have to annoyingly deal with this alarm until we nicely stop this train and hopefully fix the fault. We have climate control. I'm going to put it on fast. Oh no, let's put it on auto. There we go. I can't even select the fan. It's a bit hot. And nicely does it. Like, you see, the undercarriages on this train, I'm guessing these are the motors. Those are the diesel motors underneath this train. Right, power. We need to put to neutral. If I can get neutral. Come on, get neutral. Oh, I just had it. Oh, there we go. And... come on. Okay. Why can't I turn that to neutral? That's odd. I can't turn that to neutral for some reason. Can I turn... do I have to... yeah, I have to turn that, those both to neutral. Do I have to do something here with this train? The state? Brake fault, spare, I'm guessing that's it, right? Ah, there we go. Okay, so that's reset, so that's back onto neutral. Now if I put... right, hopefully that has sorted out everything. I'm hoping. There we go. Well, we've sorted out that problem. Didn't really expect that. But now it looks like we have an all clear to Bedford. So this is not actually going to be that much of a stopping service video. I thought, you know, well, let's do something where we just, you know, go to A to B. Do a little bit of a high speed service. Why not? This train is pretty much built for high speed. and stopping services or whatever, but you know, I don't do too many videos where it's just like a nice long journey, and I think it's a nice train to do it in. We have a alright route to do it in with moderate scenery. So let's sit back, guys, and enjoy. This is going to be a nice 45 miles. But back to some topics which we can chat about. As I said, the undercarriage here is going to be primarily the diesel, and with this particular train, it's actually not the diesel motors that power the wheels, it's actually electric, hydraulic electric motors, I do believe. So the diesel there is just to charge up the actual electric, the batteries for the electric motor. So actually the undercarriages on this train could essentially be batteries, I'm assuming. I'm not too sure. Someone will correct me, but that's what I kind of understand with this train. I do prefer this livery now when I think about it. It's just so much better. But what was I talking about, the actual problem with this insulated cab? I think people were just arguing that it's just a little too quiet in here. You don't really get a sense of what's going on with the train, because this train, it makes a lot of noise, and I agree with that to some extent. But then there's the argument that actually in real life, probably the driver's cab is going to be, has to be well insulated, because you imagine you're a driver and you're sitting in this cab, you don't want, you know, high decibels, high, you know, volume of noise. You want to be in a nice quiet environment where you can concentrate, where you can check signals, you know, just react to anything out of the blue, essentially. So you don't really want something too loud. While, say, with older trains, you're going to probably get like a lot of noise, like especially because most of the motors and stuff were primarily within the, where the driver would be sat in, the motor car would be where the driver's sat in, like you know, the HSTs or the, you know, even some of the electric units like the Class 86, they made a lot of noise for an electric loco, and the driver had to, you know, listen to that. Well, all the passengers don't have to even worry about anything because they're sat comfortably in the carriages. We can see some buses over there. We're basically going to we're tracing here the M1, which I pretty much drive up and down all the time. It's probably the motorway and road that I use the most as my time here in Leicester, because I just drive back down when I need to go back to London, and then drive back up when I need to go to uni. So it is pretty much the road that I use the most, and it's pretty convenient, I have to say. The only thing I'm not a fan of is the bloody engineering sections, where they're just basically renovating, either they're adding an extra lane or they're changing the middle barrier carriage thing, blah, I don't even know what I'm saying, where they're changing that, or they may be like near the beginning of the M6 into Birmingham, they're adding a new flyover to connect up to the M1. So, and in all those areas it slows down to 50 miles per hour, and I swear some of these stretches last for maybe about 20-30 miles. And to be honest, like, 50 is not a bad speed to travel at, I'm not gonna lie, it's not a bad speed to travel at. But it, you know, when you're traveling at 70 constantly and then you slow down to 50, you notice the difference. Like, if I was just driving from A to B at 50 miles per hour, I really wouldn't mind, because you're driving at 50, you're not going any faster to realize that it's any kind of difference of speed. But when I increase to 70 and then when I go down to 50, I just notice it so much, and it just, I don't know, it annoys me. It's a little bit of like a pet peeve when I drive. If I'm going to be driving somewhere and I'm driving constantly at a nice fast speed, like 70 miles per hour, and then all of a sudden I go down to 50, like, and I'm still on a motorway, it just annoys the crap out of me, because I don't want to be driving 50 miles per hour. Like, it just feels so slow. Like, I understand, like, on dual carriageways, or like, you know, when you're driving slow in the city or whatever, but when you're on a motorway, it should just be 70 primarily. And I get when it has to be 50 miles per hour, like, say, when workers and stuff are on the road, like, for safety reasons. But when there's no one there working, can't they just bump it up to even 60 or something like that? But to be honest, I'm going to tell you a little bit of a cheeky secret. I don't really... Well, to be honest, most people... reality check here. Most people in real life do not drive by the normal speed limit. And I'm no exception to that. I do sometimes go over... Not too much, though. Not something like when I'm driving, when I'm supposed to be driving at 70. I don't go to 100 and blitz it up the M1 or whatever. I do go a few miles per hour off the, you know, the speed limit. But everyone does that. And then it kind of makes me feel, what's the actual need of speed limits? Because it just feels like no one really abides by them. Okay, majority do, but then you have just people that just naturally love to speed up. And sometimes I'm going at 70, and sometimes I even go at 75. And then you think 75 is like a good like threshold to get up to, and then going anything above that, even past 80, is just a little too fast. But the thing is, everyone does it. Everyone goes past 80. And I know it. I drive so much that I know that loads of people go past 80. Even past 85. Even probably reaching up to 90 miles an hour. Because, to be honest, it's not really regulated too much. There are certain variable speed limit sections on like the M1 and most motorways and stuff like that. And speed cameras. But they don't really... They only catch the people that are doing ludicrous speeds. Like, you know, going past 100... 110, you know, blitzing it down, like, you know, you can tell someone's just really not abiding by this by the law of the speed. But to be honest, the majority break the speed limit. The majority go 75 80. But the thing is, that's not so much. And the thing with speed limits is that there is a threshold, there is a kind of allowance of like 5-10% that you can go above. The thing with me, though, however, and the reason I tend not to do it... Oh, and I do apologize for that. I do have a problem with my computer where it tends to, if I'm not doing anything with it, it tends to go into a screensaver, but within the game. So that's a bit odd there with Windows 10. I don't know, because I've just recently upgraded to Windows 10. But I'll just have to probably turn off the screensaver kind of setting, because that's a bit annoying during a game, it going into a screensaver, because normally it shouldn't do that. But again, going back into speed limits, while I can't personally do too much like going over speeds, because obviously because I'm a young driver and I have a black box insurer, where I have a little black box which just measures how much I, you know, do, if I'm like braking harshly, if I'm over speeding, if I'm driving at a like comfortable rate or whatever. And because I have that black box in there, I can't, like, say, go past 80 too much. I can go over 70, and I can go around 75, bit like, in and out, not, like, constantly. If I constantly go at 75, then my average journey will see that I'm overspeeding, while if I do a bit of 75, and even I go sometimes up to 80, I'm not going to be ashamed to admit that, but even sometimes when I go up to 80, I then bring it back down to 70, and even a little bit lower than 70, just to even it out, because... As like with my black box, it just measures the average speed of the entire journey. So it, you know, it sometimes like gives me a few points, but most of the time since I've been with my like insurer, I've been like clean with speeding. I've not really overspeed anything like stupidly. Like they mark me out of 10 for speeding, 10 for comfort, and another 10 for usability, which I don't even have any idea what that is. It's like, you know, I don't have like a cap on what I should, like obviously you have like an average mileage that you do per year, but like how can you rate someone for usability? Like your insurer is telling you you're using your car a little bit too much today. I don't know, but enough talk about car talk. That was quite an interesting conversation there about essentially just speed limits on the motorway. But I just thought I'd say, because we pretty much, and well, we're not following the motorway right now, but every time I come into London on the M1, I always, you know, it's nice to drive up with the Midland Mainline on the last portion between essentially Mill Hill Broadway. It is a nice, sleek train to drive. It's very comforting to drive. It's not. It's relaxing. I don't want to go back in the passenger view, because I feel that we'll just go back with the kind of telephone ringing, and that's just so annoying. But yeah, there you little two camera views, which are just quite nice. Oh yeah, we have a little achoo. Someone's got a cold. I can report my voice is actually pretty good in this video. And told me in the previous like OMSI video that I did, is that I need to be a bit more enthusiastic. And I do apologize if in some of my videos I don't like sound enthusiastic. It's just generally when I record, I've been recording and my voice has just not been there. I don't know why. It just like my voice is like normally fine when I'm not recording, but most of the time now recently when I do record, either my nose goes blocked up, and I hate recording when I have my nose blocked up, but the thing is, every time I try and leave it, then it'll become like such a gap between like videos or whatever that I just have to record it even with a blocked nose. And I hate when that happens, and even it's slightly a little bit happening now. I don't know why, because my nose is really funny. Like, it goes blocked up when I talk a lot like this just directly now when I'm just having to use my voice just primarily for talking. And it's weird because when I passively talk, it's fine, but when I'm now actually, you know, primarily just talking because I have to talk, it's starting to get a little bit blocked, and I hate that. And that's the kind of thing that kind of makes the kind of recent videos that I've been doing just a little less exciting for me. And also because I've a few weeks ago and a week ago, whatever, I had a cold, I had a throat infection at one point. So when I have those kind of things, it's not the most uplifting thing to have while doing a video. So in some videos I might not feel, you know, as up to it, but this video I feel I can, you know, a little bit got some spring back into it. And also another thing where I might feel a bit down is because obviously I have so much university work, and it's a huge thought in my mind. And even when I record videos and stuff, I'm always thinking about it, and that's just the type of person I am. I love to overthink, overanalyze things. I love to think so far into the future that it just makes my head hurt. And and this is like something that all my friends and all my well, not all my friends, but my family mainly talk about. Like, my sister just tells me, like, why are you thinking so far ahead? Just take it one step at a time, go with the flow. And the thing is, I am a very go with the flow person, but I'm like, in a way, I feel I have a split personality in some sense. I have that kind of laid back, go with the flow attitude, but then I have a side. And I apologize for that again. My computer just went a little bit sidetracked there. But I have a kind of split personality in a sense where I have that personality that's overthinking things all the time, overanalyzing things over time, and it's a pain to live with that kind of personality, because I'm always overthinking things, and it just makes your life just so much like, why can't you just accept things? Why can't you just like not overthink about things? And I would love to do that, but I just always have that in my mind to overthink things, to overanalyze things, which just, in a way, it sometimes makes me depressed, because I just hate thinking about everything, or like I hate thinking about things too much. It just it makes me sad sometimes. It makes me just annoyed, and but that's just the way I am, in a way. And I'm trying to get better at, I suppose. I don't want to make it like, you know, like I don't want it to consume me or take control over me in a way, because like I have this fun personality and this fun, like, easygoing, go with the flow kind of attitude. But then I have this other thing that just makes me overthink things, and just makes me kind of think about things too much. And in a way, it's good to have a bit of both, I suppose. It's not like, you know, it's not a bad thing either to just be one of those, or just, you know, be happy all the time, be like go with the flow, whatever. I'm not saying, well, some people are all the time overcritical, overthink too much or whatever, and that's just, you know, well, that's just a personality or whatever. But I just have that kind of split as well, where I have those kind of two sides, which they shouldn't technically be able to work, because if you're someone that overthinks things, you're not really go with the flow, because you always want to know, you always want to know what's happening, what's going to happen. And that's like half of me that is always at that. I always want to know what's going to happen, what's the future going to happen, what am I going to do then, here, wherever, blah blah blah. And sometimes it just gets to me, and it just gets me annoyed when I just overthink like that, while other times I'm just going for flow. I don't really care what's going to happen tomorrow or next week or whatever, and I'm just easygoing. And it's just, I always flip in between those, and it kind of can get a bit annoying sometimes. Anyway, look at that. The one thing I don't get with like scenarios and stuff like that, why isn't there more of these kind of things where you're seeing trains, like you're following trains within the same direction? Because I would love more of that. I know there's like less opportunities with kind of single branch lines where you just have like two tracks going bidirectional, while here is quite lucky because you have two sets of branch lines. You have the slow line and fast line. But one thing I wish I see more in these kind of like in these kind of settings where you have like a slow line and a fast line, or just you have two branch lines or whatever. I'd love to see more kind of stuff where, there's a, another train going in the same direction and kind of following you, or you're trying to catch up to it. Like, it's always you're just most of the time seeing trains going the opposite direction, and that's cool and whatever, but it would be nice to see more trains going in the same direction. It just, Or like, I don't know, at a station you stop and then another train switches onto your track for a junction or whatever, and goes a little bit on your track a bit and then switches over, and then you can go. I don't know, it's just those kind of situations. I don't really see too many of them. Like, that was a nice situation there. I hope I get to see maybe a few more First Capital Connect 319s before we hit Bedford. That would be really, really nice. Pardon that, I'm babbling on quite nicely at this rate. There's nothing else really with the cabin I have to say in terms of, let's see what other kind of view. You have this view, which is just non-existent. It's basically like the Pendolino as well. Just literally the side companion doesn't really get a view. It's just, you're just kind of looking into a wall. Anyway, let's do a little flyby. Just been in the cab all along. That is lovely. Who misses the Midland Mainline? I think it was I don't know if it was a good TOC. Like, was it reliable? Did it have good, statistics or whatever? I don't know. Didn't really use it actually at that time. I only just been using them since I've been going to uni, essentially, with East Midlands Trains. Keep mixing up loads of things. There's just so many East stuff. East Coast, East Midlands, Virgin East, East Mainline, and all sorts of East. And then you have like Midland Mainline, which I remember when I did my first Midland Mainline video, I was struggling to say Midland Mainline route or whatever, because there was just so many M's. But I've got it now. I've got the hang of it. It would have been nice to actually see some HSTs running along this scenario with the Midland Mainline livery. That would have been quite nice as well. I don't know who Midland Mainline were owned by. I'm not too sure. I know East Midland Trains is owned by Stagecoach, which owns Southwest Trains as well. And the Island Line on the Isle of Wight. They also own, I'm not too sure what else they own in terms of train operating companies. Yeah, I think it's just East Midlands Trains and Southwest Trains. I do believe currently that's what they own. But Stagecoach are huge. Oh, well, Stagecoach technically own Virgin Trains. Well, actually, no, they own more of Virgin Trains East Coast. They own like something like 90% of it. So technically, that's a Stagecoach route. But obviously they're branding it Virgin Trains because Virgin Trains is just much more appealing. It's much more, it has a fresh look. It's more appealing to customers. While the Virgin Trains on the West Coast Main Line North, or just the West Coast Main Line, well, we're saying North, North is just a section of it. The West Coast Main Line, I do believe they only own like 11% of it or something like that. They own about 40. So it's like almost half-half, but I do believe the actual Virgin company own slightly more, like a few percent more, so they kind of overall own basically the Virgin Coast Main Line with Virgin Trains, while the Virgin Trains East Coast is primarily, in a way, basically owned by Stagecoach. So, just to kind of get that. So Stagecoach own that. I don't know if they own any other kind of TOCs because you could kind of tell with Stagecoach, with in terms of Southwest Trains and East Coast, what was it, East Coast, East Midlands Trains, is that they have a very kind of similar livery kind of pattern, where it's that kind of like blocky red, blues, and yellow oranges in a way. So in a way, they have their whites. So with Southwest Trains and East Midlands Trains, they have their kind of whites, white trains, which are the kind of expressed, faster, limited stop services trains, like with the class 444. And then on basically the Midland Mainline, they have the Meridians and the HSTs to do these kind of long-haul services, while you have the more blocky, fuller colours like the blues and the reds, where like the class 455 or the 450. And then on the Midlands region, they have the 153s, I do believe, and I think, do they have some 150s, or I don't know if they have any 150s left, but they're basically in blue, and those are the kind of like, you know, suburban stopping service kind of trains. So they have that kind of color scheme that works for them. And I don't know if there's any, I think that's basically it. The only kind of exception is the Island Line on the Isle of Wight, where they've just kept the 1938 stocks in the kind of same original London Transport colour scheme. And then they had that kind of thing where they put the dinosaur livery on it for a bit. I don't know if they still have the dino trains, I'm not too sure. But the reason why they have those dinosaur trains, and which is pretty cool, it links also to what I do as a degree as geology, is that on the Isle of Wight you can find extensive dinosaur fossils, and that's where I think most, well, I don't know in the country, but you can definitely find quite a bit of dinosaur fossils in on the Isle of Wight. It's just to get a little bit technical here, so if you don't know too much about geology, I'll just brief you in a bit. The Isle of Wight essentially is basically chalk on the like kind of top surface, where you basically have the chalk cliffs of Dover, etc., and it follows all around to Southampton, and then also the Isle of Wight is essentially all of Cretaceous chalk, and the Cretaceous period was about, and I'm really going to be scrutinized for this, but I should know it. It's around somewhere like 200 million years ago. So yeah, 200 million. Cretaceous is like a huge period which has loads of epochs within it. So you have like the Jurassic, Triassic periods within the Cretaceous. Oh no, I don't know. I get mixed up. I don't. Every time I think about geology when I do like videos, it kind of all gets muddled up. So I'm probably telling you something wrong, but it's sort of right. So you have this Cretaceous chalk, and you have loads of these kind of like, this was the period basically where the dinosaurs were. They lived during the Triassic and not too much of the Jurassic. People tend to associate dinosaurs with Jurassic, but actually they're actually more Triassic than Jurassic. And when they got extinct, because of we don't know yet, it's kind of like there's loads of theories, like there's meteor strikes, there's volcanism, there's just I don't know, some widespread kind of weather kind of event or whatever, but they got extinct and they got preserved, and that's how you get fossils and stuff. And then basically on the Isle of Wight, that's a nice area there where you get quite a lot of those kind of dinosaur fossils. So yeah, if you want to go dinosaur fossil hunting, the Isle of Wight is a good place. I don't know where specifically on the Isle of Wight you can find good fossils, but I just know you can get fossils on the Isle of Wight. That's essentially why I think the dino train was, you know, painted with the kind of dino livery, because, yeah, dinosaurs on the Isle of Wight. So there's a little bit of a geological fact for you guys, you know, because it's cool for me to integrate some of the degree that I learned and as like my main kind of occupation now in my life. And it's just nice to kind of bring it on YouTube a bit as well. Why not? Just to educate you guys. And in a way, sometimes it might help me out a bit. Like, I can recall information that I learn and then just talk to you and become like a bit of a lecturer. Well, a bit of a YouTuber lecturer in some sense, where I'm just throwing some facts that I know to you guys. So, you know, just spreading the love, spreading the knowledge. The only difference is I'm paying $9,000 per year for it, so you're getting it for free. But, you know, all is well. Actually, one thing on the Midland Mainline, I know that you had some class 321s in the livery of Midland Mainline. I didn't particularly like them on the 321s. I think they were pretty ugly on the 321, but this train rocks out this livery pretty good, I have to say. Looks very nice, looks very lush. Let's do another flyby. Ooh. Thank you for the alarm. Lovely. Good stuff. We have about 5 miles left until Bedford. That has gone pretty quick, I have to say. I've just been talking, which is good. I had a lot to say during this video, and I hope you enjoyed the commentary. And anything I've been talking about, feel free to get involved in the comment section down below. I try and respond to everything I can, if it's respondable to. I do have sometimes problems with people who whose accounts on YouTube do not allow me to respond to them, so I can't respond to you. It's essentially the reply button gets grayed out, or I can't actually, like, when I type something to you and I press send, it doesn't allow me, because probably on your account settings you've just put on the settings that you cannot don't allow people to respond to my comments or whatever. So I have not a lot, but there are people that I can't respond to. So if you wonder sometimes why I can't respond to your comment, or I haven't responded to your comment, it's essentially because of that. Or maybe it's a comment that I don't really need to respond to. I normally give a thumbs up to all the comments that I read. So if you see a thumbs up by me, that means I've read the comment. So that's just an assurance there if I haven't replied to your comment. Just to let you know. Train communications. Is there... Oh yeah, I forgot to do that. The little NR video test. No, I don't know why I'm doing it now. There's no real point. I'm on the way. Before I do it.
This is a NRN radio test call.
Very nice. I do like that. I like when they add those kind of things. And I wish more of these kind of features and stuff like that can be added into the cab and just make it a bit more immersive. And hopefully in the Unreal Engine 4, that will be something which could be utilized a bit more, make it a bit more interactive, make more buttons do more things, because all these buttons in real life do something. And this is a simulator, so why can't every button in here technically work? You think to yourself. Anyway, we are currently now just slowing down. We have just under a mile as we are in the approach to Bedford. I generally hope that there is a section past Bedford, hopefully up to Sheffield or whatever, or even past Sheffield, that gets added to the game. I would love to be able to drive those kind of sections on the route. It would be just fantastic to go up to Leicester and even beyond, because it's actually a very nice route, the Midlands kind of region up to Sheffield or whatever, and even up to Derby, etc. So it'll be such a nice thing to add to the game. I hope I'm going to be able to slow down here. Apparently one of the things with this train also is that the brakes are a little bit on the wheezy side. I can confirm, not as bad as the 450, and pretty much in all my kind of general opinions of like new trains now, I'm basically going to give it a rating of like, is it 450 or not 450, and this is not totally not 450, but it's not a 450, and I have to say, it is alright. And to be honest, I was coming in a little too fast there, but I managed to hopefully slow down like that. That is not too bad. And to be honest, not many of these Meridians tend to stop at Bedford, so there's no real correct place to stop here. There's no markers or anything, because generally East Midlands don't tend to, or Midland Mainline back in the day, because we're basically in 2006 here, they didn't really stop here, so... You know, we'll just ignore that. Oh, the FPS is terrible here because there's so many AI. There's still fast kappa to connect. We haven't totally gotten rid of them. And this is generally here, this little platform 1A, which will be, I think, for the class 153, I do believe, as I was mentioning, all the kind of trains and stuff that run on the Midland Mainline and now East Midlands Trains. Anyway, well done, driver. You did a good job this evening. Apologies for the brake issues early on the journey. No problem. That was a nice little addition there thrown in. I didn't mind that too much. And thank you. Can we just get rid of that noise? Annoying. Anyway, targets completed. Operational errors. We only sped twice, which is not too bad, actually. Not a bad journey. What do you guys think? Tell me your thoughts. Overall, I like the train. It's a nice addition by JustTrains. I probably would say the Super Voyager 220 and... No, 221. The Super Voyager is the 221. People have been correcting me. The 221 is the Super Voyager and the 220 is just the Voyager. Those trains, the previous product by JustTrains on that train, I would say is probably better. This is a nice kind of addition and a nice attempt to kind of replicate the 222. I think they've done an alright job. I wouldn't say it's a bad job or whatever, but I don't think it's a near enough perfect job as like the 220 and the 221 was done, because most of the stuff was just copied over and this wasn't really done like as a unique kind of thing like the Super Voyager and the Voyager were done. But overall, it's a nice addition. It's playable. And you have three liveries, you have Midland Mainline, you have Hull Trains, and you have East Midlands Trains. So you have a little bit of variety there. You can play Hull Trains on the East Coast Mainline. So a little bit of variety there. The link, again, for it will be down below for JustTrains. That's the only place right now you can get it. I don't know if they're ever going to probably... There's probably like a year delay for when most stuff on JustTrains gets imported to Steam. So right now you can only get it on JustTrains. Hopefully in the future it'll be available on Steam, and then it becomes workshop compatible, I'm guessing. So overall, I enjoyed it, and I think overall as a product it's pretty good. Again, the shoutouts for this video go to Stenny2210 and Trainz GaimZ and Models. That's again Stenny2210 and Trainz GaimZ and Models. Their links and stuff will be down below. I hope you enjoyed this Train Simulator 2016 video. And I will see you guys in the next video. Take care and have a lovely day. Bye, guys. We ain't never-